What's up, everybody? This is Brian Grant here, Fail Kingdoms. I got my man Ari here. We're here today with the second episode of our Fail Kingdoms podcast. And today we're going to talk about a couple more things that we wanted to address the first time. But like we said, we're going to keep on going with this and try to explore a lot of different topics and talk about a lot of different things. So without further ado, this is today.
So today we're going to talk, before I get started, I'm going to make sure and I'm going to press it so much that on August 6th, we're going to have Dr. Josh Rasmussen and Rachel Rasmussen on the show to talk about their new book on universalism. So be sure to cop that. We'll let you know when the actual show is released. So be on the lookout on that. So today we're going to talk about our testimonies, in a sense, and we're going to talk about what evidence persuaded us into the faith. So, Brian, you can go ahead and you can start.
All right. Well, I guess just jumping into things, the short and sweet version, which is not so short and sweet. But I suppose when I'm talking about what brought me to all of this, I suppose the thing I want to mention is when I first got saved, I guess. Because I already said, you know, we shouldn't go way far back, but, you know, so I can come back to that later, like the very, very beginning. But I guess I'll talk about the walk that I started. That would have to be when I met my wife, which was just, you know, we only known each other in school at the time. But we just started dating and stuff, obviously. But she was already Christ-oriented. She was already saved. And she wasn't the type of woman to push me into anything. She just said, you know, hey, if you want to go to church, you can. You don't have to go because I'm going. Like, I was smoking weed. I was drinking liquor. I was doing crazy stuff because of prior experiences. And I just thought I could get into a relationship with this woman and pretty much still do old things like that I used to do in another relationship. So I kind of started off really rocky with her, but the thing that was really different about her was that she really just opened my eyes to what kindness, and I guess I could just say she really opened my eyes to what Jesus would be like, because I had always known because of Ari here, like I said, because of our past, but to know and see true kindness come from someone that, I mean, of course a love interest, but I mean, you know you're doing something wrong, and this person isn't shaming you. They're not bashing you. They're not throwing you under the bus or pointing fingers. They're saying what you're doing is wrong, but I'm not gonna, you know, judge you for who you are right now, because that's who you are right now doesn't determine anything. Like, you have every right, just like any of us could get saved right now, and our whole lives would be changed forever. So she let me do me, and one day I made a slip up, and I told myself I was going to quit the drugs and drinking and stuff. And I even told Ari, remember I used to say all the time that I'm like, yeah, I'm smoking weed, doing this, like, bro, I used to do it all the time. Like, I don't even, it got so bad to the point where I wanted to keep him away from it too. I didn't want to like so much brag about it, I guess, but it's like, I can't explain my life without saying what's really happening. So I would tell him things too, and it's just wrong. Like, it's just, why? I don't know. You just do it just to do it, I guess. And eventually it just came down to the point where I said I was going to stop. I told my girlfriend at the time, I was like, wow, like, I'm going to stop. You're right. I'm stupid. I'm just going to get myself straightened up here. And she got so happy, because she never once said she wanted me to stop. Like, she never once said, you know, you should do this, or I'm leaving you if you don't. But like, deep in her heart, she did want me to stop. She did want me, but she let me make my decision, because if she had to run me, then that's not a real relationship. It would never work between us. So in the end, like, I said I was gonna stop. I did it one more time, smoked and drank and whatnot. She found out, and I had found out something she had said about me. She said that she was so disappointed in me. She told another family member, And when I heard about that, it really hit me inside, and I decided to stop for sure. Like, I'm done. And I was going to church with her at the time because just to show face, and the save face, I mean, and just kind of show her that, yeah, I like church if you like it. But she really helped me see that I was wrong, and I started seeing a good interest in church myself, because I was like, why am I smoking? Why am I drinking? Why am I doing these things? Like, if there's no reason, why am I mad all the time? Why am I always doubting myself? Why is this beautiful woman, like, who loves me for me, like, giving me this chance? Like, I want to learn more. I want to do more. I want to be where she was at, because she was so confident in herself and everything. So it's kind of started from there. I kind of went and got saved. You know how that goes. You go to the church and thank you, Jesus, and he touches you. And so we are, for those of us who are saved, you know that feeling. I can't, undescribable, besides liberating. So, what really helped me get on my walk was, I would like to say it was my wife, but at the end of the day, she was just nothing more than an influence for me at the time, because she just helped guide me there without guiding me. It's weird. It really is strange. It really is strange to say, but if it wasn't for her being a good representation of what Jesus was like, giving me that chance, always loving me, even though I made a mistake, and always forgiving me if I did something wrong, like, she was just very understanding, and she helped me realize that what am I doing with myself? What am I doing with my life? So maybe I should give this faith thing a try. Maybe I should give this Christian walk a try, because my life hasn't been good so far. Everything I've tried doesn't work. So, I mean, I want to feel what she feels. She's happy. Every time she would go to church, she'd be depressed before she goes to church, or frown face, and then she'd go to church and come. I'd go over to see her, and then she's just bright and cheery. She's happy. I'm like, man, I want some of that. Like, when I want to feel good. I want to come out feeling like shiny and nice. So, but yeah, it was really my wife, and that really helped me turn and see my own, take a good look at myself, I guess you could say. And from there on, like, I kind of just started this walk, and I guess the rest is history, but we will discuss that another time, because I already have to jump into his. So,
I don't know. I mean, for me, like we both obviously grew up in church, and so that's obviously going to be some form of camaraderie there because we both grew up in church. We both like have some type of periphery view, understanding of Christianity. Excuse me. Gotta cut that one out. But
3, 2, 1.
3, 2, 1. But I think what I would say about mine is that there was a time in my life where I was coming into my own self. I was thinking for myself. I was having to adopt responsibility for my own actions and for myself. I was going into college and I was always an intuitive person. I was always a person that, I didn't want to just accept something just because you said it. Like, I wanted to find out what is going on a deeper aspect of what you believe. And so I always had questions about, my faith. I've always not that I was doubting, but I've always had questions. And obviously, and it's no fault of them, but they just didn't know. They just didn't. Really, my family and people that were surrounding me, they just didn't know the intellectual side of Christian faith. And so, like, I didn't fault them for that, but they just sort of couldn't handle the questions that I was putting forth. And so, I mean, and obviously they wouldn't because they just didn't know about that kind of thing. But I needed that. But it got to a point where I was just like, okay, well, I have these questions. I still believe in God. I still believe in Jesus. I just don't know. I just don't know if I can have these questions answered. And I was like maybe like 16, 17. And it got to a point where I really started to question my faith. This is after I graduated. I graduated high school. It was my first year in college. And I had a psychology professor, and she wasn't she I wouldn't say she was an atheist, but
Oh, yeah, I remember.
she was a she was the type of person that she wasn't friendly to theism and to Christianity. And so we were because it's a psychology class, it's a psychology 101, we would inevitably, talk about B.F. Skinner and Sigmund Freud, and Sigmund Freud was not a theist. I guess you would call him an atheist. But she quoted this passage. I was like, completely out of context. Like, this has nothing to do with what we're studying at that point. We were studying I think it was called like conditionalism, conditioning, something like that. Something conditioning is basically where you. Like you reinforce patterns of behavior by rewarding every now and then whatever the subject. And so she quoted this quote from Sigmund Freud, and he basically said that God is a fairy tale. And I'm paraphrasing here, but she basically said, Sigmund Freud basically said, well, God is basically a crutch for Christians and for people who believe in God because they're afraid of what's going to happen when they die. They're afraid of not having any purpose. And so I was like, is that true? So it's just, I mean, I it wasn't compelling to me that he said it. It was just like, wait, people can actually think like that about religion? I didn't know that. And so after a while, I just started looking at more and more. I started looking at Sigmund Freud, he's the psychologist, and I was like, okay, well, he was obviously somebody that was against religion. So I was like, well, I don't really know that many people within my realm of knowledge who have this like really, really negative view of religion. And so I started searching these people. I was just curious. I was just like, okay, what do they think?
Exploring.
I was like, yeah, what do they think about this? And so it sent me to Bill Maher. You know who Bill Maher is? Well, he's this talk show host on I think it's HBO, and he's an atheist. Like he's a straight up real deal atheist. I don't even know how I went from like Sigmund Freud to Bill Maher. I don't know how I don't know how it happened, but it was just a lot of rummaging through the like through internet resources and whatnot. And I looked at Bill Maher. And I just started watching some of his videos about, he's really vocal about not his hatred for Christianity, but he has a disdain for religion, period. And so after that, I stumbled upon this video, this documentary, I guess. And he goes to the, I think it's called the Something Experience. It's like in Orlando. It's basically like a Bible theme park. I think it's called like the. I can't remember what it's called, but it's basically like you have it's basically a theme park for the Bible. It's actually called the Bible Experience, I think. Anyway, but he goes to the Bible Experience and he starts to interview people. Like obviously you're gonna assume that almost everybody who's there is a Christian because it's a
Yes,
Christian
sir.
park, so people are just gonna be. So he went there and he started interviewing people. And he started to ask, okay, are you a Christian? Are you a believer? They'll be like, yes. And then he'll start asking these probing questions about their faith. And then he started to ask, he said, well, are you aware of the very fact that Jesus was modeled after these ancient pagan deities like Horus? And I was like, what? And so this infographic came up, and all these graphics started to come up, and it started pointing out all of these similarities between Jesus and Horus. And then it started doing it with a different god from ancient god from there.
Does it ever bother you that the story of a man who was born of a virgin, was resurrected, your bio, was something that was going around the Mediterranean for at least 1,000 years? We've got Krishna, who was in India 1,000 years before Christ. Krishna was a carpenter, born of a virgin, baptized in a river.
Are you saying that was written in history? That was written down in
Well,
history, is what you're saying?
absolutely. There's the Persian god Mithras, 600 years before Christ, born December 25th, performed miracles, resurrected on the third day, known as the Lamb, the Way, the Truth, the Light, the Savior, Messiah.
Stop! Blasphemer!
All I know is that I don't go by that.
Then he brought up sword. Well, after that, I watched it and I was kind of brought back. I was like, whoa, wait. Is Jesus or just a copy? Like, it was like everything that we have in the Gospels, is that just a copy of something that we think we know? But it was just actually stolen from those. It was just actually stolen from those other people. And so after that, I just started looking. I just got more and more wrapped into it. And yeah, I eventually stumbled upon something called Jesus mythicism. It's not really a big thing, and it's not taken seriously in academia. But I didn't know that at one point. So basically, I just stumbled upon all these Jesus mythicists. And then, have you heard of it's called The Zeitgeist. It's a documentary film. And at one point, it's not necessarily completely about religion, but it's about, like, they talk about, you know, how the currency is controlled by, like, the Illuminati and all that different type of stuff. But they have a specific section in the Zeitgeist documentary where they are refuting religion. They're refuting Christianity. And so they bring up the same thing that Bill Maher brought up in his film, Irreligious. I don't even know how to say it. But in Zeitgeist, they brought that up. So they started talking about all of these comparative deities that kind of look exactly like Jesus. And I was like, whoa, okay. So I had to stumble back, and I was like, okay, well, maybe I ain't hearing nothing from the Christians about this. Obviously, there's a plethora. I mean, the reason why, like, most Christian historians and scholars don't focus on it, most of them, well, all of them pretty much, is because they just don't take it seriously. They're just like, look, this is bunk history. Nobody takes it seriously. Mm-hmm. But I didn't know that at the time. So I'm looking like, okay, well, if Jesus is just a copy of these pagan gods or these pagan deities, then did he actually exist? And so I mean, obviously, I'm already in the affirmative that Jesus existed. So I'm like, okay, well, let me see what everybody else on the other side is saying. So I'm Googling evidence that Jesus didn't exist. And so I'm hopping on all of these different things that I'm reading so much. And so I stumble upon Bart Ehrman. He's a very reputable scholar at NC Chapel Hill. He was an evangelical Christian. And then while he was in college at Wheaton College, which is a Christian school, he abandoned his faith. So he's an agnostic atheist now. And I was like, okay, well, and he's a very reputable, respected scholar in New Testament studies. And so after that, I just was like, whoa, okay, wait. There's a lot of stuff going on here. And so I purchased this book on Kindle. It's called, Forgery. Basically, he's talking about the Gospels are as forgeries. And so I really didn't know. And so after that, I just read so much, and I was like, I don't see anybody responding to this. That's really a bad thing. I don't see anybody responding to this. And so it just put me in a mindset that, okay, look, I really can't accept Christianity to be true. And so even after that, you know, I'm reading Bart Ehrman, and then I even stumbled upon Richard Carrier. He's a Jesus mythicist, but he's a doctor. Like, he has a PhD in history. It was like, so, but obviously he doesn't hold a teaching position, so, because nobody takes him seriously, except atheist people. But I didn't read all of his book, but I read a lot of his blog posts. And he's just calling everything, jab after jab after jab. I was like, yo, that's really not good evidence that Jesus existed. I mean, and the Gospels aren't reliable. The New Testament, a lot like the 15 and 16 books that are attributed to Paul, like maybe the vast majority of them wasn't actually written by Paul. And then you have all of these different manuscript errors in text invariants in terms of our own manuscripts. So we probably don't even know. Like, there's so many mistakes in the Gospels and in our manuscripts. It's like, he, you know, Bart Ehrman, he would be like, yo, there's over 400,000 mistakes, textual variants in our manuscripts. And it's like, I don't really even know. I can't trust this Bible anymore. And so, I mean, I didn't tell anybody after that. So I was like, I'm just not convinced anymore. So I renounced my faith. I didn't tell anybody because, like, it's my parents and, you know, they've been in Christianity for so long. I didn't tell anybody. And I was with Maria at that point. Mm-hmm. And Maria was just like straight up, you know, going to church every Sunday, every Wednesday, reading her Bible. And I'm literally sitting there reading the Bible with her. And I'm like, bro, all this stuff is bunk. And I'm just reading it with her. And I was still in college then too. And it was my second semester of college. And I was just like, look, I can't do this thing. I can't pretend anymore. So I don't think I told Maria that. I don't think I told Maria that I wasn't a Christian anymore. I just told her, like, I was making her aware of the very fact that I was doubting. And this is when I was really doubting my faith, not just questioning, but doubting my faith. And it got to a point where I was even like, okay, well, this is where I was. Okay, well, they lied to me about everything else. Okay, well, what even about God's existence? Now, I never went to a point where I became an atheist. I was to a point where I became agnostic, where I was like, look, you just can't know whether or not there's this dude, there's this dude in the sky that created everything.
Yeah.
And so I just really didn't know.
But up to Jesus' point.
Yeah, but and so for me it was like, okay, well, I effectively just stripped my entire moral foundation, my entire purposeful reasoning to live, and it got to a point where I read Friedrich Nietzsche, and Friedrich Nietzsche is an existentialist philosopher, and he's an atheist. He really understood Christianity, but he just didn't believe it. And so, you know, he's one that coined the phrase "God is dead and we killed him." And what he meant by that was when you strip that underlying foundation from your worldview, you're left with basically nothing. Like, how do you justify your moral position, your moral view that murder is wrong? It's like, but you, because you stripped away that moral foundation when you stripped away religion, mm-hmm. that foundation there, and now you only have is your rationality. All you have is your you, and. Like, it really just sent me into existential despair, and I got depressed. I was like, what's my reason to live? Like, what is my reason to live? I don't see any reason to live anymore. So it got to a point where I was like, I was literally contemplating killing myself, because it was like, okay, well, even then, it won't even matter, because God probably don't exist and Christianity ain't true. Mm-hmm. I'm probably just going to go into the ground and rot forever. So it's like, why postpone that inevitable death, and why not just get it over with now? That's where I was. And I was just too cowardly to do it. I'm just like, look, I like living. I don't know why I like living. I can't justify why I like living, but I like living. And so I was in college and I was going to work then. And so when I was at work, I just broke down in tears. I was just like, Lord, look, if you real, I need some confirmation right now, because when I get home, I'm going to end it, because I don't see any other reason to keep this going, to keep this facade going, if there's really no reason for it. And so, like, I cried, I broke down right then and there, like in the bathroom. I was on break and I just cried and I just broke down. I was like, Lord, look, if you there, like, let me know, because I don't know what to believe anymore. And I feel like I was just depressed and I was just done with everything. And so after that night when I got home, I was still living with my mom. Mm-hmm. When I got home, like, I was just scrolling through Facebook and I was like, and I'm really, it's in the back of my mind. I was like, look, when everybody goes to sleep, I know my mama got some, like, oxycodone or something. Like, she has pain issues. She didn't, you know, she had pain issues at that point. I was like, I know somebody got something in here. Like, Tylenol, I'm just down the whole thing, just get it over with. And so while I was scrolling, because everybody was still up, so while I was scrolling, I was just like, Lord, are you going to answer me or not, you know? And I stumbled upon this guy that I know on Facebook, and he posted this video, and it was this guy, William Lane Craig. And if anybody knows who William Lane Craig is, he's like one of the world's most like best known Christian philosophers. And I was like, it's an understatement to say how impressed I was at this man's prose at delivering an argument and successfully rebutting whatever his interlocutor threw at him. And I wasn't convinced yet, because I was, sometimes you get to a point where, like, you're at a point in time where, like, it's just gonna take a lot to move you off of a stump.
Yeah,
that's kind of where I was. So it didn't matter at that point. It didn't even matter how much I heard and how much I absorbed in terms of apologetics. I just still was there. Like, it was like a volitional not wanting to. It was just like so much religious trauma in my background. And even trauma about, like, me feeling like I was being lied to all my life. That made it extremely hard for me to accept Christianity again. But after a while, it really did. Like, I was like, look, I think it's true. I was like, Lord, just give me the power to soften my heart. Like, if the Holy Spirit is real, then, like, Holy Spirit, move on the inside of me so you can move this log from my soul that's blocking me from making the next step. Because it doesn't, like, at that point, it was like, look, it don't even matter how much evidence I get. I just don't want it. I just don't want it to be true anymore, because there's just so much baggage, emotional and volitional baggage that's attached to Christianity that I didn't want. But eventually, I came back to faith. So, I mean, I guess that's the short version of it. That wasn't even short. But what would be one of the things that, like, one of the, like, I'll tell you this, like, for me right now, I'm not even, if I was where I am now, back then, I would probably not be a Christian. Because from where I am now, and just reading more and more and more, and like getting the more nuanced positions, like, you know, chiseled out from the scholarly literature, I'm like, some of the things that I was convinced of in the past, I'm not so convinced of anymore. Not necessarily saying that I don't believe that the resurrection happened, because I do believe it, but it's just that I'm kind of more skeptical about a lot of the claims that Christian apologists and Christian historians tend to use to proffer up the Christian faith and why it's reliable and, you know, all this stuff. So I guess right now where I am, I really do believe, and I'm convinced, because I know how I was back then. I would have, like, jumped ship by now. I really do think that it's a genuine move of the Holy Spirit as to why I haven't left the faith. Because where I am now, like, I don't doubt. Like, I feel no volitional reason to leave the faith, to not be a Christian anymore. It probably is like, it's like some psychological type things. You know, I have a wife now. Mm-hmm. I have a family. You know, I need to find some type of belief system to ground, you know, more morality and ethics in terms of my children, all this different type of stuff. It might have some type of psychological reason behind it, or at least partly. But where I am now, I would say that It's only a move of the Holy Spirit that's keeping me in the faith right now. I'm up on the utmost. I'm convinced of it. But if someone saw the evidence, the historical evidence for Christianity, and they were like, "Yo, I'm not convinced," I would have been like, "Okay, I kind of understand why you wouldn't want to be a Christian after going through all of the evidence and all these different types of stuff." So for me, it's like, well, I'm convinced because of the Holy Spirit, because of the move of the Holy Spirit. And it's not an apologetic for somebody else to become a Christian. But for me, it's an apologetic for myself. Like, it's an experience that I had to experience for myself in order for me to become convinced of the Christian faith. So that's the thing that's holding me now. So, and obviously we probably won't have the same thing, like, right now where you are. Like, what would be the thing that's convinced you of the, like, if you can point out one thing, what would be that one thing
that's keeping me here?
That's keeping you.
It's really hard to say. I mean, it's kind of touched me right now, honestly, but I don't know. I mean, I would say I'm in a real rocky place right now, like where I was. It kind of jumps on and off because I see all the blessings that I have. Like I discussed in the first episode, like I kind of went from just having a wife with nothing, pretty much. We didn't have a place to go besides her mother's. And I mean, I had a car, but and she did. But I mean, it just seemed like we didn't have much. And then you ask God for all these things and he blesses you. Like he kind of comes through on his part, you know. And I've had some really like tough experiences dealing with the flesh and pornography still. And only recently have I, proud to say, overcome it. But it was just so weird. It's like, how come? Like, it's some of the things I discuss. Like, I really, sorry to be all mumble, but like, it's just in my songs that I'm going to be releasing, you know, with along with Failed Kingdoms or as a part of Failed Kingdoms, it kind of really makes me feel bad because like you make some really great, like the music that you made recently is so unique and like just every song is like just an explosion of different like colors to me. It's just so like diverse and there's so many different sounds, and especially the way you're coming out of singing and then rapping and everything you talk about is all different. I'm like, man, like even in your most recent song, like I'm just like, how can I play that? Like, how can I like keep up with that energy? I mean, I hear this. I have a lot of songs done that I can't wait to release, but like, I'm like, is this really good as this? Because the things I talk about is like, man, how come I'm a Christian and I'm still in my faith and praying, reading my Bible, you know, doing all the stuff that you said Maria was doing. And you're just looking at her like, man, this is, like, I'm kind of there. It was like, how come I'm a Christian, but I keep slipping? How come I'm a Christian, but, like, I keep failing? Like, how come if God is so good, you know, how come, why is it bad for me to sin if he's going to forgive me anyway? Like, I kept jumping back and forth, and then it's like God would always snap me back out of it. Like, I'd be there, and then, like, just, I feel like you said, the Holy Spirit would just come to me and be like, you know, what are you doing? Like, come out, snap out of it, because you're confusing. I have a real problem with my mind. My mind really juggles me all over the place. Like, it has really troubled me my whole life. And even now, it's just a real battle to fight myself, really. But honestly, what's keeping me there is, like you said, it's weird. It's really weird. But like, honestly, it's the Holy Spirit. Like, at the end of the day, I mean, I believe the resurrection. I believe Jesus died for all of us. I believe that there is a God that's for us. And I believe that the government is bunk and there should only be one king. And that's just him. But like, I can't erase, like, there's a slight doubt in me because of me. Like, I don't care about everybody else at the end of the day. I mean, there is a world full of evil, but like when we point the mirror and the finger at ourselves and look in the mirror, like it's just like we're all nasty human beings that just keep on slipping up no matter what we do. And like you hear it in church and all the time, like, oh, all of us aren't perfect, but God loves us anyway. And it's like you said, like, what's the point of even trying if he's just going to love us anyway? I don't know. It's a real tough but you see how it's a frustrating thing for me still. It really is a frustrating thing. It really is. So the last couple of months I've been dealing with that mentally and emotionally because I'd be at work and I'd just really be struggling with myself. I really would like be thinking like, God, why am I still having a problem with pornography? And how come I'm still doing this? And like, but in the whole coronavirus thing too, it really made things worse because I couldn't go to church. I was literally just started going regularly. Everything was good. And then this happened. Now I can't go to church. And now I have to lean more on the Bible and reading and more on prayer and more on, you know, just God without the church aspect. And it really made me feel like, man, like this is tough. Like, how can I do this on my own? I have my wife, of course, and the Bible and the people from church, but it just feels like I've been out in the desert for in the wilderness for a long time. And I know he's there, but sometimes I really have thought like of turning back. Like I really thought of, you know what? I don't even want to be doing this Christian thing no more. Why? What's stopping me from, let's just be real, from masturbating in the car? What's stopping me from going out there and doing something completely crazy, you know, that'll risk everything that I've worked so hard for? Like, in all honesty, stuff that'll make people look at you and be like, what's wrong with this dude? Like, what's stopping me from doing that? I mean, in all honesty, what's stopping all of us? So for me, it's the Holy Spirit, man. I can sit here and testify all day about stuff, but for me, it's the same as you. It's been really the Holy Spirit that keeps coming to me and shaking me back up and just saying, just really showing me revolutions. Like, just look at all these great things, not just the blessings, but like how far you've come. And honestly, it just, like you said, it's the Holy Spirit for me. I mean, I've had encounters with God. Like, I really have. I'd be driving home from work, and like you say, you were in the bathroom. Like, I was driving home from work one day and going to her mom's house, and I'm literally freaking out in my head. I'm like, I was literally driving, listening to Christian hip hop, and I'm just thinking to myself, like, what is wrong? Like, something's wrong with me today. And like, I just literally screamed at the top of my lungs, like, what is, like, like, what is wrong with me? Like, why do I keep failing? Why do I keep, God, where are you? Like, what is this? And I'm telling you, I was driving, and I'm promised, I was driving, it had to be a second to where you wouldn't even be out of it for, you know, as long as it felt. But bro, she killed me so dumb. Well, she really do. But it couldn't have been that long. It had to be a split second, but it felt like I was with Jesus for like at least 5 minutes. I had a vision. Like, I was driving, and then I'm telling you, I was in my emotions. I was screaming. I was aware. I'm not saying like, oh, hallelujah. No, I was screaming. I was hurt. There's no way like something could have came and shook me up. But like, I'm telling you, like, in a split second, boom. Like, all I felt, I'm sitting in the car driving, crying like this, you know, covering my tears and just driving. And like, I feel like I'm standing up. There's light all around me, and I don't see his face, but I see a man that's in robes, and all white. And I'm driving, and it feels like I'm not in the car. I'm standing up, and somebody's before me, just as you are right now. And he came, and all he did was hug me. And I just put my head in his shoulder, and just, I knew it was him. And like, I was still in the car, and I bust out in tears, like, more than I was. I was hollering, like, God, I'm so, like, stuff started pouring out of my heart. I'm by myself, and I'm saying, I literally was like, God, where are you? I'm hurting. Like, why do I feel so bad? This, and this. I went from that to, after I had that vision, like, in a split second, I was literally weeping so hard, saying, God, I'm so sorry. That's the only thing that came out of my mind. I'm so sorry. It felt so real. I'm saying, like, I felt his embrace. I really did. And the only thing I could say to him is, I'm so sorry. I'm sorry for, you know, the doubting. I'm sorry for the questioning. I'm sorry for all this that I'm doing. I'm sorry for me right now. I'm sorry that I'm so, that I'm me. I know you love me for me, but like, you gotta admit, it's me. So, I mean, honestly, that was my make or break point. I mean, it might be crazy to some people, might even be crazy to you. I don't know, but like, bro, I'm telling you, like, I had a moment. And I mean, a lot of people can probably sit there and say that, I won't say crap in church, but like, a lot of people say that stuff, and you're like, where's my moment? Like, I need my moment. Like, you over here, you'll testify. Like, but okay, I'm saying, I was searching for him. He showed himself for a split second, and it really felt like, man, like, okay, that's all I need. Like, I'm gonna try to keep going strong. And like, even now, church has been open for maybe 2 or 3 weeks now to the public, and I haven't had time to go because I keep making excuses. I'm gonna be real, but like, I've been reading my Bible. I've been listening to podcasts. I've been trying to get more into the failed kingdoms to make music that I'm gonna be releasing soon, within a week. So I've really been I'm more strong now in my faith than I ever have been because of the Holy Spirit. So that's the one thing that really has kept me here, going, moving along, especially with failed kingdoms, is the Holy Spirit. Because it's like, forget all the bunk, like you said, that's a good word, I'm gonna use it. But honestly, it's the Holy Spirit. Like, you just, it's one of those things you can't explain. It's just, There's no reason for me to do what I do. There's no reason for you to do what you do. And it's like you said, you could stop any moment. You should stop any moment. We should all stop and be like, man, you know what? Forget this. Who cares? But why don't we? Is it because we ain't crazy? But there's a feeling that we both share. And it's just like, man, why do we feel like this?
Yeah, well, before we transition over into to a different place, what would you say, at least like in terms of evidence, what would be one of the pieces of evidence that you would think like makes you trust the Gospels?
Oh boy, this is a tough place for me because I'm still at that point where it's kind of like the Romans 12 and 13 thing, like how it jumps from one. The Bible say one thing and then it'll come back and say another, but it's the Bible. So as Christians, you know, we're supposed to be like, oh, you know, yeah, everything's here. But I don't know, I really can't say, though. I'm still kind of leaning back on a lot of the things that you've told me in the past. I mean, I know back then you were in a certain place and so on and so forth, but I mean, I took my little nuggets from whatever you had to tell me. So I don't know, my number one evidence would still, for me, I don't know. That's crazy. I don't want to be all like, wow, look, he doesn't even have proof. No. I mean, it's not like that, but it's, I didn't mean it is like that. But honestly, it's like I said, it's just the Holy Spirit for me, because I was a person of complete negativeness, and I was a person of complete, you can ask this dude 100%, I was a complete nothingness. I don't even say if I don't know if I was atheist or if I was just a nothing. Like, I don't know what the heck I was. What was I technically? I don't know. I don't even know honestly what I was.
I think you would be characterized. I don't think you were an atheist. Like, I think you just didn't like God.
I think
you've always believed in God. I just think you didn't like him. So I think you would be like a, like, he would be like a regretful theist. Like, you don't want it to be true, but you just kind of know it's true, but you don't want it to be true.
That's a good one, yeah. But yeah, I mean, I just honestly don't know, because I was really in a dark place a lot of times. Obviously, suicide and anything that could come to, even now, you know, it still passes my mind certain things that are really crazy and stupid, but it's like going back to what I said, like, why don't I do the unthinkable? Why don't I, you know, is it just because I'm a basic human being? Like you said, you're just too pathetic, or you're too scared to take that final step, or, you know, to do the impossible? Or is it just, I don't know, but I can't really describe it as that. Like, for me, in those dire moments, like you're saying, like you said before, you were in that moment, like, it's in the back of your head. You know, you think about your family and you think about this and that, and you're just like, love y'all, but this is it. You know, y'all gonna always love me for sure, because I'm about to end it. I mean, y'all better pick and choose, because, like, y'all can't choose. I'm saying, like, but anyway, I'm saying, like, it just really comes back down to what I had just said. Like, why don't we just do the crazy things? Why don't we, you know, be crazy people in the end of the day? Why don't we just go out killing people, hurting people, and being gossipers and just whoremongers and just all kinds of crazy stuff? It's just that gut feeling that you get, and I call that the Holy Spirit for me. So, like, there's just some things that, not just morality, but I mean, because if it was just morals, then I mean, I know a lot of things are wrong, you know, that I do that are sin, but I still do it. You know, so I mean, I can't pick and choose with those. So for me, it's just definitely the Holy Spirit is just my only evidence, because I've seen some crazy things all my life. I have been in some pretty tight situations, and for sure there was no way out, and boom. And it's like, why? And it really feels, if I go way back down the timeline to when I was deep in a hole, you know, crying for my soul, like, I don't know what's wrong with me and stuff, I can literally trace way back there and come all the way back to where I am now. And it's like, God has really been pulling me along. You're closer. You're so much more closer. I mean, the rope is never ending, sadly, but it's the fact that I pulled that much rope to get to where I am now. Mm-hmm. And if I didn't like follow the Holy Spirit and like do what God has really much instructed me to do, and like to not give up, to keep on this walk, and to start believing the things that I do, then I feel like I would still be that same guy. I still would be out on the street somewhere smoking weed, or probably even dead. You don't even know. Like, it's just like I reset. What's my purpose? Why not just end it sooner? I mean, I thought the same thing too. I mean, it's like I'm smoking and drinking and doing all these crazy things, and nothing's making me feel better. So why go for the latter? Why go for God when that's the craziest thing of all? Like, I don't know. But for me, it's just unexplainable. For me, it's just the Holy Spirit. So, but by all means.
Well, I think for me, like I'm wholly convinced that Jesus existed. I think the evidence, the historical evidence, is overwhelming. I don't think any skeptical scholar who holds actual legitimate positions in universities, I don't think that they would ever doubt that Jesus actually existed. I'm confident that the crucifixion happened. I think it's just way too highly evidenced in history, and you know, in our manuscripts, and Josephus mentions it. Tacitus, who's a Roman, I think he was a governor. He mentions it. Then Mara Bar Serapion, he mentions it, and then the Talmud, which is the Jewish Talmud, it mentions Jesus. It calls Jesus a witch, basically, but you know, nevertheless, you know, it mentions Jesus. You know, like, I'd rather be mentioned. I'd rather you know me as a. You know, I'd rather you know me in a bad way than you not know me at all. Mm. But yeah, I just think it's just way too evident that Jesus existed in the past, and I think his crucifixion is evidently obvious. Like Bart Ehrman, who's an atheist and he's a New Testament scholar, he says, look, the crucifixion and Jesus's existence is one of the most well attested facts in ancient the ancient world. And it's like, yeah, like it's undeniable in my opinion. As for like historically proving the resurrection itself, I don't know. I think the evidence is kind of like, I know like people like Mike Lacona and Gary Habermas, and they're New Testament historians as well. They would say that you can actually derive the resurrection as actually happening from the historical evidence. I'm not so sure about that necessarily. But like, I do believe that the apostles, they actually believed what they said they believed, what they actually saw, what they said that they believed they saw. Mm-hmm. They actually, and they took it a lot. Some of them did. Some of them took it to their deaths, or at some point they were willing to die for it. Then some of them didn't die, or they were just willing to be. They were willing to suffer for the belief that Jesus, that they had saw Jesus resurrected from the dead. They saw Jesus alive again after his crucifixion, mm-hmm. and. I don't really see any reason to believe that they had any, like they benefited off of it in any way, shape, or form. Like, I mean, I don't see any like ill motive that you can postulate that accounts for every single person. Like for Paul, I think Paul is always going to be a stone in the shoe of any skeptic. But you know, Paul was trained under Gamaliel, who, you know, under the Sanhedrin. Very educated, well-educated Jew. He knew what a false Messiah would look like if he saw him. And he wasn't mourning for Jesus' death, you know, because, you know, skeptics tend to say, well, when you mourn somebody, and it's actually true in the scientific literature, when you mourn somebody's death, some people often see, like, sort of like apparitions of those people mm-hmm. late after that. So they start hallucinating that they're actually seeing the people that died because mm-hmm. they cared about them so much.
Yeah.
And it's just so much emotional, psychological stress put on their brain, put on their mind. But I was like, okay, well, that could probably work for like Peter and like the 12 apostles because they were so close to Jesus. But it wouldn't work with James, who was Jesus' half-brother, because the Gospels clearly say that Jesus' brothers and sisters thought him to be a lunatic, thought him to be crazy. So they, like, after the crucifixion, James probably would have been like, man, like, my half brother is dead. Mm. But he was a heretic. He kind of deserved it. Like, he thought himself to be king and to be God. Like,
yeah.
They heard, like, they probably likely have heard these things, Jesus say these things. And according to Jewish tradition, that was punishable by death. That's blasphemy. So he probably would have been like, well, he kind of deserved it. I miss him, but he kind of deserved it. So he probably wouldn't be in that position to see Jesus in an emotional state or whatnot. And so it's like, it's James and Paul for me. James and Paul stick out like a sore thumb in terms of, like, actual conversions. And it makes no sense for me as I look at the historical data for Paul to ever think about converting to Christianity. It makes no sense. It was like, and so I think the only reasonable position to take in terms of why Paul became a Christian was because he actually witnessed Jesus on the road to Damascus. That's mentioned in the book of Acts.
Mm.
That's the only way. And then Paul clearly says, like, yo, like, he mentions in his epistles, I think it's in Ephesians, it's probably not, but don't quote me on it, but it's in his epistles, and he says, like, yo, I was a person who oppressed Christians. I was there when Stephen was stoned, and I supported the stoning of Stephen, and now I'm one of them. So it's like, that makes no sense whatsoever for Paul to just automatically come out and say, yo, Jesus is risen from the dead, and he's the Yahweh that we Jews believe in. That makes no sense in terms of Paul.
Mm.
So I think Paul really did see Jesus. I mean, but the point is that it don't make it, like, that appearance of Jesus doesn't make any sense in terms of who Paul was in his condition. And in terms of James, it makes no sense for James to convert to Christianity. Like, it would take a lot for me to be like, yo, Adrian is the son of God and he's Yahweh. Like, it would take a lot for me to believe that. Like, mm-hmm. It would take overwhelming evidence for me to start saying that my brother is Yahweh. My brother is God. And so it made no sense for me to be like, well, it makes no sense for anybody to posit that Paul was going through these psychological distress or whatnot because of Jesus and all this. Like, he didn't know, he probably knew who Jesus was, but he didn't care. Like, he thought they were heretics and then they were worthy of death and persecution. But then all of a sudden he's like, yo, I now become one of the ones that I was persecuting beforehand. It's like, bro, he really did see Jesus on the road to Damascus. Like, he's not lying about that. Like, he's really telling you the truth. And even in terms of, like, why I think the resurrection narrative, I don't think that it can actually be copped up to be legendary. Like, it wasn't there at first. This wasn't the early church's teaching. Because you have in 1 Corinthians 15, I think it's 3:15, I think, but you have a creedal passage. Paul quotes the creedal passage and he says, for I delivered to you what was given to me. And he quotes his creedal passage where he says, like, yo, Jesus was crucified and then he resurrected from the dead. And then he, over a period of like something, something days, he appeared to over 500 people. And then mm-hmm. he appeared to the 12. And last of all, he appeared to me. It was like, Bart Ehrman, who's not a Christian, he's like, yo, this is the earliest evidence that we have of the resurrection belief. This is the earliest evidence that we have because Paul in 1 Corinthians is earlier than the Gospels.
Mm-hmm.
So it's like, yo, this is the earliest, and most people would date it back to maybe like 2 years post-resurrection. So like maybe like 37 AD. So it's like, well, it depends on what you think. Like 30, maybe it's like 25, maybe it's like 35 AD. So it probably started before then. And so you get to 37 AD. This is like when the resurrection narratives actually really started to happen. So it's like, it's right on the tail end of the resurrection appearances.
Mm.
And this is the oldest Credo-Pat, this is the oldest evidence that we have of the resurrection belief in the early church. And it dates back to not even two years post the crucifixion. And it's like, yo, just all those kinds of things. I'm not saying that it proves the resurrection, but I'm thinking like, yo, this probably makes it more possibly true than not. So those are the things that like I'm convinced of right now in terms of the Christian faith. Like I'm not a person who believes. I mean, let me ask you this: do you believe in inerrancy? Like, there's no errors in scripture or whatnot.
I don't know. There are some errors in there that just don't make sense to me.
This is the thing for me, because like growing up in Protestant churches, and not necessarily where I came from, but like when I really started to get into like specifically at Life Church. They don't really talk about inerrancy of scripture, but we had this life journey course thing, and we talked about the inerrancy of scripture, like in First Timothy 10, and they say, yo, this pretty much tells you that scripture is sufficient for pretty much all Christian living, and there's no is inspired, is God breathed, and all this different type of stuff. I was like, well, I didn't come to my Christian faith believing that. I believe that the Bible is inspired. I just didn't come to my Christian faith believing that there's no errors. And so that's what I'm not saying that that is not inerrant. I'm just saying that for me, I'm open to some contradictions in the text. Like for instance, it's probably a good reason to believe that, like within the Gospels, Jesus says something, and I'm going to like completely destroy this, but Jesus says, tells the apostles, yo, after the resurrection, after the appearances, he says, meet me in Jerusalem. But then an angel appears and he tells them to meet them in a different place.
Mm-hmm.
So for me, not even Mike Lacona, he's a New Testament, he's a New Testament historian. He's like, yo, this is possibly a contradiction, possibly a historical contradiction. And so for me, that's why I don't really stake my whole entire Christian faith on like the inerrancy of scripture. Like I don't believe, for me, like I think like for me, like I don't believe that Yahweh, that a lot of the stuff that's attributed to Yahweh in the Old Testament, it's actually Yahweh doing it.
Mm-hmm.
Like when it says that Yahweh told the Israelites to slaughter all the men, women, and children, and even livestock,
and take the women as sex slaves. They deserve it, you know.
And I was like, I highly doubt that Jesus that I read in the New Testament would say anything like that
mm-hmm.
in the Old Testament. I'm not saying that that's an error in the Old Testament. I'm just saying that I have a much more man-centered understanding of inspiration. Like, I don't believe that when it came to inspiration, Jesus just, like, God just, like, enveloped these people's brains and they just, like, clicked and then they just started writing like they were possessed or something. Like, no, God, through his power of providence, he used these men to write down what, and he didn't really deem it important enough to fix the false understandings of who he was at that point. Now that doesn't, I don't think that calls into question inerrancy necessarily, because I think Jesus just corrects it. But I do think that like for me, it's more so of a reason to like maybe inerrancy isn't true, or maybe there are errors. Like that's heresy to a lot of people. I remember I was talking to this pastor. He was like my former pastor at Life Church. And I didn't say that I didn't believe in inerrancy. I just said, like, he quoted 1 Timothy. I was like, I don't think that means what you say it means. I don't think that gives you good reason to believe in inerrancy. And it was like, many Christians believe that that's kind of wobbling on the verge of heresy, almost to the point where like you can damn yourself by saying that the scripture isn't inerrant. But that's what I wanted to say. But after this, talk about the singles that you're going to be releasing. Talk about the music that you're
doing. All right, well, I will be having a few singles out pretty soon. Obviously, I'm going to do it one by one, hence single. But anyway, my first single is gonna be called "Not My Will," okay, and it's gonna be dropping next week. I'll be putting out more details on Instagram, Facebook, and just kind of having Ari give me a few artwork ideas and so on, so we can just. I know it's been a while since I released anything in general, so everybody's wondering who the heck is this guy. Everybody keeps talking about they and who is Phil Kingdoms. I thought it was just him, but the big surprise that yes, I'm still here type of thing. But so it's not like a big bang I'm trying to do waiting, but a financial point of view and everything like that. So, but as Ari instructed and told me, pretty much taught me is that, you know, I don't need to wait for a name basis to get myself out there or nothing. We are Fail Kingdoms, and it just kind of made me realize, you know what, I just want to get God's word out there. So, and then what God has put on my heart to speak into song form. So, but anyway, yeah, I'm gonna have Not My Will be coming out pretty soon next week, and more information will be coming about that, and soon there'll be more singles to follow. So keep your eye out for that, obviously. And is there any other little things?
No, I think that's it. Well, guys, thank you for tuning in to the second episode of the Fail Kingdoms podcast. We'll probably film the third episode maybe next week. We have it posted next week. So again, my name is Ari.
Brian.
Thank you for listening. We'll see you next time.